itself is called the Toronto Video Atlas of Surgery. And it's essentially an online surgical video library. You can visit it at TVASurge.ca. I do have to give a fair warning, there is surgical footage up here, so if you're not comfortable with seeing blood and guts, then do be warned. We do a lot of mostly HPV, pancreatic, biliary, which is basically the liver, the pancreas, and the bile duct surgeries, along with a lot of the transplant surgeries that happen at Toronto General Hospital. The main aim for this is really just to document most of the cases the surgeons do there, and for trainees to learn about what approaches they can take when tackling either simple or complex cases in this field. We do have a little bit, I guess, of a selling appeal or a uniqueness to the surgery library is that we use a lot of computer animation. I can show you a little bit of a highlight reel. Don't worry, there's no blood and guts in this one. Computer animation. And then walk you through a little bit of what we do. So basically, we go from, you know, animating blood vessels, how they're sutured together, very, you know, step-by-step kind of instructions on what exactly was done in the surgery. We can talk about, you know, the various pathologies that happen in specific cases. We can talk about, you know, how a kidney transplant can happen or a liver transplant can happen. We also talk about, you know, resections, livers that have cancers in them, how blood vessels can get reconstructed in the course of resections. And then we can talk about very specific suturing techniques and things like that. What else? Of course, and we talk about a little bit of the VR stuff that we're doing that correlates specifically to, you know, very unique patients and their anatomy. And we also talk about, you know, the minimally invasive procedures, keyhole surgeries that happen, and how to manage that. This is one of our earlier VR modules. And most recently, we've actually gone into the OBGYN, babies, and gynecological procedures. And that's kind of how we've been expanding the video atlas. We started with a very small specialty, but we are trying to see if we can get more surgeons and more medical trainees that are interested to document their cases and have us just make animations of them to put on the atlas. The aim of it is we want this to be a open source, free resource for any trainees online so that they can understand or, you know what their options are when they're tackling certain procedures. It really does help when we get feedback from your doctors around. We actually got one, I think, a few weeks ago, and we were really happy as a productive at the production team, where a surgeon from New Zealand, he mentioned to, you know, one of our surgeons, saying, "Hey, I looked at your case on this website, and we did exactly what we did to try to cut out a pancreas tumor, and the patient turned out well." They were very grateful for that kind of resource, that they felt inspired in a way that you can actually do certain things this way. And they felt confident enough because our surgeon did, and everything turned out okay that way. So we're really happy about that kind of feedback, and that's why we really want to keep it as open access as possible. We don't want to put it behind a paywall. We don't want to say, "Hey, subscribe and $1,000 per year," kind of thing. It would help us financially, but it's not what we want to be doing. So this is kind of, hopefully, will be ongoing for a while. And of course, we kind of go back to, you know, who exactly are we? But to start, we actually were, I guess, founded by two HPV and transplant surgeons. So Dr. Ian Gilbrey is one of our lead champions that are, you know, he's still kind of manning the entire initiative to this day since 2011. And Dr. Paul Greck has also been, you know, very instrumental in helping us get on our feet. Now he is retired and he is actually part of two bands. He plays the guitar, and we hope to see him open in, I think next fall. I think he's having a show or something. It's very, very interesting. The OBGYN staff, we have collaborated with them since last year. So these are surgeons that are actually across GTA. One is from St. Mike's, one is from Mount Sinai, and the other is from Sunbrook. So the Dr. Elian Shore is, Dr. Elian Shore is from St. Mike's, Dr. Mara Sobo is from Mount Sinai, and Dr. Sally Genyong is from Sunbrook. And we kind of come together to, you know, group their expertise in various procedures in various sites. And we've been going on for a year, and hopefully we can continue to expand that chapter. Who are we? We are, for lack of a shorter word, biomedical communication specialists. We have four of the specialists on my team, including myself, and we also have a manager, Dr. Carter Tate, that kind of takes care of all the administrative and red tape things that we don't have to deal with, which is really awesome. But the term biomedical communication specialist is a little bit, I guess, obscure or, you know, not heard of, so let me give a little bit of context on that. This term comes from, actually, we all graduate from the same master's program at UOT. The master's is in biomedical communications, and from their website, this is actually a pretty succinct description. Students or graduates in this program explore the use of images, interactive technologies, and animation and simulation to effectively communicate complex science and health topics to a large array of audience. But in our terms, we use surgical video and computer animation to communicate the surgical and anatomical aspects of procedures to mostly practicing surgeons or trainees. This program...
Oh, I think there's a question over here.
Yes.
It's great for this team and for the people in this program.
Yep.
Are the typical undergraduate backgrounds in sciences, the life sciences, the kind of the technology and software or communications? What's the
That's profile? A good question. So in the UFT program, they actually select for candidates that have a heavy training in sciences, whether it's biology, whether it's chemistry, whether it's, you know, whatever branch of science it is. If you have a good undergraduate background in that, you have a little bit more higher standing.
Okay.
Based on the belief that they feel the science is much more important than the rendering knowledge, let's put it that way. They feel like it's easier to teach a scientist to do or train them up to do rendering techniques or animation or sketching, rather than having a really good artist understand the science behind what they're trying to communicate. So that's kind of the background of the candidates that go in. I've been told that this year there's actually there's an MD PhD somewhere in the States that came to apply for this just because she wanted to know a little bit more about medical illustration, but she's already done, like, you know, a huge kind of science for a long while. So that's interesting to know.
So is the technology proprietary or is it something that's commercially available that this program is then using with kind of the knowledge of these biology and medical people?
Not necessarily, though. A lot of the techniques that they teach within the program, they're kind of widely available if you sign up for a course somewhere, you know, learn how to do computer animation or just, you know, sketching and things like that. It's just they want to narrow down the specific kind of communications. Like if you're talking to lay audience or talking to a professional audience, how should you structure your sketches, your animation, your videos, things like that, from that kind of skill.
Thank you.
So the program actually came or evolved from what we call medical illustration. As long as anatomy and medicine has existed, there has been a need to visually understood that and knew how to present that to others. These are sketches from what we consider the father of medical illustration, Max Pagel. He's a German artist that did a lot of the medical studies in Germany and came over to the States to John Hopkins before the Second World War. But that's when he kind of started his own practice at Hopkins, and eventually it became five programs within North America that practice medical illustration. But of course, as we know, communication, technology, and also medicine itself has evolved and advanced, so we can't just rely on static sketches to communicate all the very complex science that we've been kind of subject to. So as our toolkits become a little bit more expensive, you can see works like completely fully rendered computer animations about molecular immunology. This is a 3-minute full feature animation that one of the students would come out with at the end of the program. And this is all completely vetted by the scientists that do that research. Let's say for Sonia, she actually has a PhD student that's working for her right now. That hopefully next year we'll have a animation that explains the research that she's currently going through. This can also take part in, let's say, a video game. So there has been a interest in investigating whether or not you can combine video game interactivity with learning. So there has been a student that came up with a game of vascular invaders. Mm-hmm. Basically trying to go through your entire body and go through all the main blood vessels as a defender, trying to defend your body from the invaders that are coming in to quick happen. But all of the programming, all of the scripts, all of the graphics, that's all kind of made by the single student. And that's kind of how things have evolved from just sketching to a whole wide array of tools that we use to communicate these principles or complex science matters. Which kind of brings us to what we do. So, I mentioned earlier that we actually make the computer animation based on specific CT scans. And this is kind of how that process happens. We look at the scans, then we try to delineate what structures, what by coloring them in different ways. And then we take all that stacked information and try to make a rough model based on that. This is a stylized kind of pipeline of what we do. But that's essentially what we start with. Now the CTs have the MRIs, try to tell what's what, and then recreate that into something that's in 3D. And of course, throughout that entire process, we have to fact check everything with our surgeons. Yes?
What's the granularity of each slice?
We can work from 3 cm and finer. If it's more than that, then it's a little bit difficult to
find. And so how fine can it be done? I guess what's the limit there?
We've seen 1 cm slices that work very well with us. But the other part of the spectrum is anything other than 5 or 7, we start getting super weird thick slices.
So at 1 cm samples, you can reconstruct the model for learning?
1 to 3.
Okay.
But it does depend on, if you're looking for a very small branch of a certain artery.
Seems like biliary structures are very small, right?
Those are the really difficult things to reconstruct.
Okay.
Bile ducts and anything that's related to the biliary tree, we often have to consult our surgeon on where exactly does it fall. It doesn't really show up well on CT scans unless you have a angiogram where they have contrast put into the bile ducts, and it actually shows up very well at that. But not everyone can do that. The body may not tolerate it. So at that point, we would talk to our surgeon and say, okay, how do you think the bile ducts fall in the anatomy? Because there are kind of patterns we can draw from, saying, okay, it follows the artery that way, but then it kind of veers off and does its own thing. So that's the kind of thing you have to really consult with the surgeon, saying, well, we see all the vasculature, we think this is what the bile duct looks like, but let us know if that's wrong.
And if the scanning technology develops to the point where it can be more granular, say it's by the millimeter, would you be able to then build better models, or is it too much information?
It would give us an edge in the sense that we can follow everything going from the gallbladder to wherever. But because it's so elusive in the sense that, you know, it's hard to tell about them from the surrounding structures, we still would be very comfortable saying to have this checked by someone.
Sure, of course. Yeah, thank you.
And then, so with, you know, that kind of computer model that we make every single case, and then sort of telling a story, essentially. Because every single liver, every single patient is different. And we have to show that kind of background information every time we say, you know, here is a patient that has a cirrhotic liver, and this is what happened to them. And their sister, right, healthy individual, decided to donate half of her liver to the patient. So then we can go on to say, this is how the surgery went for the sister. The liver was split along a certain line from the gallbladder all the way to what we call the posterior groove, which is right in between the two major veins. And the reason for that is, you know, you kind of trace that vein down so you have a nice border to cut along. And then what happens is this is the part of the liver that goes to the patient. I'm going to stop right here because it's going to get a little bit graphic. Okay. So that's kind of, you know, how we start the story. These are the main kind of points of what's going to happen or what the background is, and then we can delve into what actually happened, and we can complement live surgery footage with the computer animation models that we made just to make sure everything is communicated clearly. And again, if you're interested, the online site is right there. We have about 80 cases as of now, and we do a monthly release at the end of the month, every month. So of course, what's next? We have all, we continue to build this surgical library, but we also find that we have a whole collection of computer models that we can utilize. One thing we kind of have touched on is what we call photogrammetry. So the approach to make 3D models was to take the CTs and then try to, you know, make distinctions between the structures and then make them into 3D, essentially. But what if we can make 3D models just by taking pictures? So let's say I have a phone, I take 20 pictures around it, you know, 360. I take all that information and I can build a 3D phone in VR right away. If we can apply that to organs, don't worry, that's a cow part, that's a paper. But essentially what we're trying to do is we take, you know, 50 photos of this at different angles, 50 photos of this around different angles, and then we can have a 3D model with this kind of detail. You can see all the fat and all the muscles in 3D, and it's almost instantaneous. We don't have to go through the CTs anymore, we don't have to go through the MRIs, we just capture what we see in the surgical field, and it becomes 3D right away. It saves on our workflow, and also kind of has that realistic element to it. Yeah.
So if I'll reveal my lack of understanding here of CT scans. So I think the CT scan gives you the cross-sectional information. This is just external. Is that the difference here?
Yes.
Okay.
And then if we try to, I guess, combine the two, you have the internal structures, but we also have like the outside realistic, appearance or everything.
Right.
I'm wondering if that kind of adds to the immersion.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
That's one thing that we're kind of going into.
So what would be the use case for this one where you have taken the external photos and built the model then?
So that would be, let's say, a lot of the, when you have a liver graft, a liver transplant, you typically put it in an ice bath.
Mm-hmm.
You try to label all the names on that before you go, you know, put it in someone else. Yeah. If we take the photos there and say, you know, this is the graph that's going to go to X person, that might serve as a good addendum or an external module for our videos, or even our videos, just say, this is exactly what it looks like.
Because the surgeons can actually see it in advance then, right? If it's being transported from one place to another.
Exactly.
Okay, that's pretty neat.
Then they'll know, like, okay, when it gets to our center, what exactly we have to do to match our recipient right here. So, another thing, of course, you've seen all this already, but this is the VR model for just anatomy education. If we were to put, you know, a in that space, what can we do with it? Can we tell people a story? Can we tell the surgeon, you know, this is what the patient's liver looked like? You can go ahead and grab it, locate it in whatever orientation that feels more comfortable. But we also wanted to add the function of, you know, selective information. So if we have a control to say, look, we don't want to see a liver, and we don't want to see the gallbladder, and we just want to look at the vasculature, and we just want to look at the tumor. So you see in the middle there, as that finger will show you, there's a big tumor, big round thing over there. And we can kind of tilt our heads, what exactly is, you know, going on around it. We can turn off some more veins, more vessels. And while we just look at the purple portal vein, make it a little bit bigger so we know exactly what we're looking at. So you see how the portal vein actually goes into the left and the right branches. And we can kind of duck under and say, hey, look, this little branch here actually isn't affected by the tumor. So we can start thinking about, you know, if we were to do a resection, what exactly are we cutting for? And if we look at, you know, a different kind of anatomy, here's the arteries now. That's the main aorta. And we're going to talk about, okay, this is the artery that carries blood to the liver. But you can see very clearly, some of it is affected by the tumor, and some of it's not. And if we put that kind of all together, trying to see through the tumor. Okay, these are the small branches that are already affected, kind of envelope within the tumor. And now, of course, the bowel ducts. Same thing, look at what the bowel duct, or where the bowel duct goes. It goes around the tumor, so it's not exactly affected. It is very close to it, so there's that border that, you know, surgeons may have to look after. And if you put all of that together, I think that's what I'm trying to do with. No, you can't put veins up, okay. And this is interesting because this is where the tumor affects the body the most. It actually envelopes a little section right there in the middle there, that I can make. So this section right there, that's all enveloped by the tumor. Mm-hmm. And so we want to go in and, okay, why don't we look at the CTs and see that, why did it end right there? So that's one of the things we can do as well, is we can bring in all these different modalities into that space, so you can have like a reference of what's happening as opposed to just like the virtual model.
Is this sort of a globally available technique and technology of which Toronto is one center, or is this sort of like what you guys are doing is the state of the art?
I would put it that way, but it's localized in Toronto right now. We do want to push it to global scale.
So there's few, if anybody, doing this around?
We know there are people experimenting, but we don't know if there's like a kind of network being built. If there is, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
But at the moment, it seems like a lot of people are kind of experimenting with the silo.
Yeah. Seems incredible. Like you need to get a conference of like everybody who's trying stuff out together.
Absolutely. Okay. And of course, I think this might be of particular interest is, you know, if we were to say normal CT scan, just kind of go through, you know, in a very two-dimensional matter, but what if we put that in VR and allow the surgeon to move two planes at once? allow them to see that data set in a much more intuitive mm-hmm. manner. This is what he's saying in his headset. And you can kind of slide in and out to make sure you know where exactly you're looking at. You can also highlight structures. This looks like the best, but essentially, what he's pointing at right now, that white structure, that's the hepatic artery that's kind of being wrapped around by a huge tumor on the top there. But this is what we can do with, let's say, just raw CT data. You can feed this in there and kind of just start playing around with what exactly is what in a 3D rotational manner. And of course, where that leads to is then what if we did the surgery in VR? The reconstruction of the liver here, and we're going to say, okay, we're going to cut through the liver right now. So we cut through the liver. And you see it kind of slowly opening, and you can see that the blue is the hepatic vein that's slowly getting skeletonized, as they say. Of course, in reality, it's not as fast. But now we see the bile duct and the portal vein, and we can go ahead and cut that. There's the portal vein of the hepatic artery we need to take care of, so we cut the artery. And now we reach for this surgical staple, so we can take care of the bigger vessels. Just cut that. And at the very end, there's a little hepatic artery, sorry, hepatic vein there we have to take care of. Right there. And we will staple it. And we'll cut it. And this is a liver graft. This can be transplanted to a person that is in the liver. And the whole procedure we just did there, that is what we call a living donor liver hepatectomy. So we can do all of that in VR before the actual surgery happens. Of course, the details will be much more finer. We're not looking at major branches. We're not looking at vessels that big, because that's kind of standard knowledge for the surgeons. We're looking at branches that are not typical. We're looking at unique anatomy that they may have to look out for when they perform the surgeon. We may even want to have that in the exact same orientation that surgeons see in the OR. Because we're very used to seeing the liver in a straight on kind of fashion, but when they're in the OR, it's on the table and the patient is lying down. So it's a different kind of way that things behave in terms of gravity, and that's something that we coded in the VR space. A step further than this, then, is to put two people in the same room. All that was just one person doing one thing. What if we put two people? Here's a surgeon, Dr. Paul Gray, who's retired and playing guitar now. This is one of our trainees, Dr. Robin Visser, is currently taking a job in Winnipeg. But before he retired, before she found a job in Winnipeg, we got them in the same conference room and to test out the VR module for us. So these are the laptops we have, so this one. Both of them have headsets on. And this is kind of like a third-person camera seeing what exactly they're doing in that space. This avatar here, unfortunately everyone's bald in it, is Robin. This avatar is Dr. Drake, who and so I can play a little bit of what they're exactly doing. And that's the liver we saw from before that we were trying to split or something. You can see how his hand gesture matched directly to what he's doing. And the neat thing is, I don't have the sound out here, but what he's saying close to his headset is directly fed into the microphone that the trainee is hearing. Oh, that's amazing. But imagine this, but this half is in another country. This half is in Toronto. We can put multiple people in the same room. We can have that kind of conferencing happen. And I think that's one of the things I would want to push to say, if we were to do surgical planning between multiple centers, would this be a good solution rather than everyone just looking at CTs and kind of exchanging? exchanging notes through the telephone and things like that. This might be a better, more intuitive way to engage students. And that's kind of what we're pushing for at the moment, is to get a lot of our former fellows, which is a good thing, they all come from different countries, and they all go back home or go to other centers after 2 years. We keep in contact with them, and we would be very excited to kind of send them a set of this, say, wear this 8 p.m. EST, and then we'll guide you from there to see if that kind of collaboration can happen. So hopefully, we'll hear something by the end of the year.
So when one person is wearing the virtual reality headset and they move their head around, their perspective on the organ changes.
Yeah.
So when you have two people there, do both of them possess that, or is it sort of like a master and then everybody following it?
So right now we follow a model where whoever touches a member first gets to control it.
Okay.
So let's say, you know, I'm the master surgeon, I'm gonna, you know, rotate it however I want to.
Yeah.
The trainee can look at it and see it in his perspective, but if he or she wants to grab it, then I have to let go first.
Okay, got it.
You don't want that kind of competition between two players, because it doesn't know what to do. The first test ground we're thinking of is actually Ireland, where one of our former fellows is currently head of the air transplant department. We do periodic updates on the blog, so anything that's not a video release, we typically write up kind of technological updates every month, whether it's in the photogrammetry, whether it's the VR stuff. There were a few months that we actually bought a paperclip and tried to dissect it ourselves just to see what it looked like, or wrote a blog post about that. But that's kind of our newest